introduce to you Harvest TV English Christian Channel. One of the things I love about Harvest TV is their desire to share Jesus with the world. Harvest TV is not promoting a denomination, a specific church, or a person. Their goal is that you and I would experience an authentic relationship with Jesus Christ. The new English Christian Channel will be your place to find spirit-filled messages, Bible study, Christian movies, talk shows, kids time, and Christian music. I'm sure there's gonna be more packed into 7 days a week, 24 hours a day that you won't wanna miss.
The sixth thing, the incarnation was to bestow his righteousness upon us. We have seen that the life of Jesus is an example. That's what we see in 1 Peter. We have seen that passage, right? It is an example for us in 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21. It's an example. An example, what is an example? An example to be followed. For my life in this world, Jesus is the standard. The life of Jesus is the standard for my life. Or even you can call it a law. How should I live? What is law? Law says how we should live. So what is the law of a Christian? The law of a Christian is not just the Ten Commandments. The law of a Christian is the life of Jesus Christ. You get my friends? Huh? The law of a Christian is not just the Ten Commandments. The law of a Christian is the life of Jesus Christ. Because God expects us to live like Jesus. That's why in Romans chapter 8 we see that we are predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Okay? So how we should live? If somebody is asking that question, then we have an answer. What is it? We need to live like Jesus because that's the law. Come on. Yeah? The law of a Christian is the life of Jesus Christ. Huh? Okay? Means how we should live. If somebody is asking me, what is the law of my life? Or what is law? Law is the way I need to live. So the way I should live in this world, what is it? It is the life of Jesus Christ. Because I can live only like Jesus lived in this world, because he has given us an example, and we need to follow his example. We need to walk in his shoes. So he is the law. He is the law of righteousness. However, just because we got a law, it doesn't give you the ability to obey the law. You get me, my friends? We have a law in India. We have a law. If everybody in this who is living in India do have the courage and ability and strength to obey the law, then it would have been like heaven, right? What's the problem? We have a law, but we fail to obey it. We do not have the power to obey the law. And now we have a new law. It's a new beginning. Everything is new, right? It's no more the Old Testament things that we read. It is not, in fact, you know, the law of the Lord is not condemned or it is not taken away. It is there. But for the New Testament Christian, he need to live like Jesus. And why I say that the Old Testament law is not redeemed, taken away. How Jesus lived in this world? when he was living in this world, he was obeying all the law of the Old Testament. So you cannot say, oh, we are New Testament people, so there is no need to obey the Old Testament law. Sometimes people say like that, we are not under the law, we are under the grace. And that's the grace preachers say. We are not under the law, we are under grace. We are not under the law, that is true, but we have another law. What is the law? It is the life of Jesus Christ. And we are not supposed to give away all the law. You know why it is? Because Jesus is our law and he obeyed all the commandments of the Old Testament. What does it mean? We need to fulfill the law of the Old Testament. Not literally, but spiritually. More than that. Jesus was living more than the law. You get me, my friends? The people of the Old Testament was struggling to fulfill the law of the Old Testament, and it was a failure. Most of them, all of them were a failure. But Jesus, he was not struggling to fulfill the law of the Old Testament. He was fulfilling all the Old Testament laws. And his life was more than the law. He was obeying his Father God more than Moses, more than the person who gave the Old Testament law. So can we say that there is no need to obey the Old Testament law? We need to obey, but we are not looking to the law, but we are looking to Jesus Christ. We are looking to the life of Jesus Christ. We are not looking to the law. But when you are living like Jesus, it is certain, it is true that you have already fulfilled all the Old Testament law. Because if you live like Jesus, then there is no need to check whether I did this, did that, did this, did this. Because, you know, the life of Jesus, he fulfilled all the law of the Old Testament. You're getting me, everybody? So what is the new law that is given for us? It is the life of Jesus Christ. But just because we have a law, it doesn't mean that we can obey all the law of given to us. That was the problem with the Old Testament people. They had a very good law, but none of them could fulfill the Old Testament law because they did not have power to obey the law that was given to them through Moses. That's why, even in John, when John was saying about the coming of the Lord, he said, verse 17, chapter 1, verse 17, for the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. The law was given to Moses, John, book of John, chapter 1, verse 17. The law was given through Moses. It was only the law. Moses gave us the law, but he did not give us the power to obey the law. Are you okay? Don't be confused. Moses gave us the law, but he did not give us the power to obey the law. And about Jesus, Jesus was not just giving the law, but he was giving us grace. What is grace? Grace to obey the law. Which law? The life of Jesus Christ. Okay, my friends? Are you okay? If you have any confusion, just tell me. Are you okay? So, Jesus is the standard of my life. But he is not just the standard of my righteousness, but he is our righteousness. He is not just the standard of our righteousness, but he is the source of our righteousness. In Romans chapter 3, verse 21 onwards, we read, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness of it. The righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. That doesn't mean it is against the law, but apart from the law. Every word you need to understand. The righteousness of God is not against the law, but it is manifested apart from the law. although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. And Paul says, even in the law and prophets, that is the Old Testament, when it says law and prophets, it says about the Bible. It doesn't mean that the first five books of the Bible is law and the second book, nothing like that. Law and prophets is a phrase. It says Bible. That's the reason why when Lazarus was in the bosom of Abraham, the rich man was asking Abraham to send him to the world so that he will bear witness about things beyond death to his own brethren. And what Abraham was saying, they have Moses and prophets. What does it mean? They have Bible. What is the meaning of it? God never want to send somebody from heaven to make people believe in him. Because sometimes people say, I have seen heaven, I have seen hell. If you don't believe it, you are going to die, like that. So don't go after that kind of things. Because always the source of our faith should be Bible. That's what even Jesus said. They have law and prophets. They have Moses and prophets. About what all things, if you want to know something about life after death, God is not sending an angel to make you believe. God may send an angel to help you, that's there. But to make you believe, he will never send an angel. Because your faith, your understanding, your faith, it should be based on the scriptures. That is the way of God. So don't go after the books that says about the, what, all the heavens and earth, the hell and the imps and things like that. And also there is another thing. Paul, once he was taken to heaven, into the third heavens. You know what he says about that later? I know a man who is in Christ. He was taken to the third heavens. I do not know whether it is with body or without body, but I have seen things there which cannot be uttered to man. What does it mean? God gave him the vision, but God said, Paul, this is a special vision for you. Don't tell it to the people. Maybe God will give you a vision of heaven and all, but other than the Bible, no source God will allow to shape your faith. You understand, my friends? It is difficult for you to follow it because maybe you yourself have gone through many books says about heavens and hell and things like that. I'm not saying that they never had a vision like that. Even if they had a vision, God will never. Some people say, God asked me to write all these things, for in the last times, God has appointed me to reveal the truths of heaven to the mankind. No, God will never do that. Because for all the things of heaven and earth, we have only one source to know it. It is the Bible. They have Moses and prophets. And this rich man was saying to Abraham, Father Abraham, they will not believe Moses and prophets. They will not believe the Bible. And you know what Abraham said? If they do not believe Moses and prophets, they will not believe even if somebody is coming from heaven. So that is not the way of God. That's not the way of God. Maybe some of the things that I say, it is contrary to the common understanding of the people, but that is what the Bible says. Okay, let's come back. Now we understand that Jesus is the standard of our life, of our righteousness. And now he is not just the standard, but he is also the source of our righteousness. That's what we see in chapter 3 of Romans, verse 21 onwards. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. Even when we go through the law and prophets, you know what is happening? In between, we can read about this kind of life. Like what? apart from the law, there is a righteousness. That says even in the prophets. And the righteousness of God through faith, righteousness of God through faith, not through law, through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, for there is no distinction, since all have sinned, all have fallen short of the glory of God. So the righteousness of God revealed through a different thing that is called faith, it is apart from the law. It is not against the law, it is apart from the law. But now it is our duty to see that we are living the life of Jesus Christ in faith. Not just struggling to live like Jesus. Of course, I cannot live the life of Jesus Christ on my own. No one in the world is able to live the life of Jesus Christ with their own strength. You get me? So the problem, we are trying, we are struggling to live like Jesus, but we fail. Because we all are trying to live that life, not apart from the law, not in faith, but we try to do it with our own strength. What is the problem with the law? The law is good, but it is clearly written, those who do it will live by it. But faith is not like that. Faith is something more than that. It is trust. You can live the life of Jesus Christ, not by your strength, but you can live the life of Jesus Christ if you allow Jesus to live in you. I cannot live, but Jesus can. That's why Paul says, I am crucified with Christ, in Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. I am crucified with Christ, no longer I, but Christ lives in me. What does it mean? The life of Jesus, I cannot live with my own strength. But Jesus can live in me and live his life. Once Jesus in John chapter 14, Jesus said that the Father abides in me and he does his work. The things that I do, it is not my own deeds, it is the deeds of my Father. He abides in me and he does his work. It is exactly that is happening in our life. We are not living, but we are allowing Jesus to live in our life. And when you allow Jesus to live in you, then certainly Jesus will live in you and he will fulfill the righteousness. What is the righteousness? The life of Jesus Christ. But we need to do something. You know what is it? I am crucified with Christ because in my body, no two people can live together. In our body, body doesn't mean, you know, just the flesh. In me, in my mind, in my life, in my emotions, in my faculties, all faculties of my body, in my personality. Only if I die, Jesus will start live in me. So the only way for victorious Christian life is dying for yourself. That's why Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. If you're not crucified with Christ, you can never, Jesus cannot live in you. Because our life is a place where there is only one throne. It is a room with only one chair. And what happens? If you sit in that chair, Jesus cannot share it. The problem with Jesus, I have seen one problem. Sometimes don't think that Jesus has no problems. He has a problem. You know what is it? He will never share a chair. You get me? He will never share a chair. Many times we ask, Jesus, I am sitting here. You also sit here. He will never do that. So what happens? Naturally, we start living our life in our body. But when we die means what? We die to ourselves. And when we are crucified with Christ, then what happens? Jesus starts sitting in me and he rules over me. And that is the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So I need to die to myself. Listen, I was in Doha and some of my friends, they were coming to sometimes, you know, I meet people personally. And those young guys who are working in Doha, they came to me and asked one question. But how can we live a victorious life? How can we live a victorious Christian life? I said, there is only one way to live a victorious life. I need to say that it starts from your cemetery. It starts from your cemetery. What does it mean? Dying to self. Dying to self is the only way for victorious Christian life. That's where we are fulfilling the righteousness of God in our body. That's where incarnation becomes not just a standard for my righteousness, but it becomes a source for my righteousness. The Bible proclaims Jesus as a life-giving spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45, I love this passage very much. It says, thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. The first Adam became a living being. We know that. When God was giving life, he became a living being. It's true that he was a living being. But he could not give life to somebody else. But the last Adam, Jesus, he was not becoming a living being, but he became a life-giving spirit. What does it mean? When I lack life in my living, in my body, in my life, you know what is happening? Jesus is coming and he pumped life into me. We have seen sometimes the football, if there is no air in it, it doesn't have life, right? You try, there's no bounce. You don't get any bounce. It doesn't have life. If you put it down, it's there. Sometimes we are also like that. We are like a football with no air inside. There's no life in us. But what Jesus is doing, he is a life-giving spirit. And when there is no air in us, when there is no life in us, when there is no spirit in us, you know what is happening? He's coming and pumping life into me. And then I get bounce. You get me, my friends? And he becomes a source of my life. That's why I said he's not just a standard of my life. He's not just a standard of righteousness. He is a life-giving spirit. So that's the reason why I think Charles Price or Charles Stanley, he wrote a book. I didn't see that book. The title of the book, Stop Living for Jesus. Stop living for Jesus. Let Jesus live in you. Stop living for Jesus. We always try to live for Jesus with our own strength and we fail. But what is needed? Stop living for Jesus. But we need to allow Jesus to live in us. Let's close our eyes. 1 minute. Lord, we really thank you, Lord, for your incarnation. And you are our standard, we understand. You are a pattern for our life. You are the law in our life. We know that we need to live like you, but we do not have the strength to do it on our own. But we are not frustrated because we know if we allow you to live in us, you will fulfill your righteousness in our life, O God. So we understand that incarnation is not just giving us the standard of righteousness, but you are the source of righteousness. Lord, we were always trying to live for Jesus. But now, Lord, we want to see that we are allowing you to live in us. Let Jesus live in us, O God. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.